All right, everybody. I'm so excited to be back with another edition of the Manifestor Mindset. It's been a while, and I have a pretty awesome guest who's here with us today who's making a really big sacrifice because it is so uncool for his generation to come on LinkedIn that I'm not able to go ahead and go on Twitter afterwards. We announced this yesterday, and the best part about it is that a ton of comments saying, "That's nice, Josh, but can't you talk about normal stuff?" And people threw a lot of shade. So I appreciate right. this. It's a very uncool thing. My kids are actually coming on watching this. It's the first time they've opened LinkedIn. So it's but let me give you a proper introduction. Josh is an extraordinary young man. He's 19 years old. He's done a ton already in his life. He's known for what he's done on TikTok and becoming one of the largest influencers. Kind of hate that word because I think it sort of commoditizes what he's done, but we'll move past that in a second. Huge following on TikTok, huge following on YouTube, on Instagram. But what makes Josh different and why I really want to bring him here, he's got clearly a really strong business mind who is highly intentional with his time and always thinking about how do I leverage it? And that's how we met each other. So Josh, welcome.
Thank you, man. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. So I'd love for everybody to hear a little bit about your journey. Everything always looks like it happened overnight, only to those people who weren't paying attention. So this audience probably was not paying attention to you, but can you reconstruct how you got here? How you rushed TikTok?
Yeah, of course. So for me, the crazy thing is it all started before TikTok. Like I was on the app back when it was Musical.ly 4 years ago. So my sister got me into the app. She posted a video with me. And I was a competitive guy, used to playing sports and like being an athlete. So I was like, 10,000 followers in 2 months. That's the goal. I'm going to hit it, but I'm going to go buy it in more of a growth hacking sense than trying to post one viral video on the app. So I hired my sister, 14 years old. I put her on a 15% commission-based salary, and I got her to be logged into my account. And she was actually scrolling through the leaderboards on Musical.ly, which would tell you the top 250 spending customers. So they actually showed you what customer you essentially wanted as a business, right? You want those top paying customers. So they showed you the top donators in the live. My sister would go through the top list, follow and unfollow, like a bunch of their posts. They would see my username because she'd be logging to my account. I'd be live at the same time for 4 hours in a row. I would go 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. every single night. And what this did is it essentially gave me the top spending customer. So I was able to create a great revenue model. And then slowly from that, my growth just exponentially continued until I got on a tour in 2019 and fully got that boost into the social media scene.
So when you deconstruct your journey, what I like talking about this is people think, you know, it just kind of happens, whatever, right? Like you were discovered, you were highly intentional. What opportunity did you see? You know, but back in those early days, was it about money? Was it about influence, power?
So the crazy thing is I had two social media accounts that were big that no one knew, like there was a person behind them, right? One was a sports editing account for hockey. And then one was a overall sports editing account. And I think they both had like tens of thousands of followers on Instagram. And I would just go in and spend my day all day long trying to figure out how I could grow these accounts. I just love social media. There was something about it that intrigued me. So when the Musical.ly came along and I found that you could actually create a revenue stream from these live streams as well, I was just so invested into trying to figure out how I could turn this into a business overall. Like I love this, the idea of creating. I was an entertainer. I like to be kind of the center of attention when I was younger, you know, telling stories. So to be able to do that and get paid, I was trying to figure out what other ways are there to monetize your social media.
All right. So then you take off. Your whole life changes now. Now you're like a one-man Truman Show, right? You're constantly living under the microscope all the time. So what I'm fascinated by you is you become huge. And I think most people sort of cap out, right? When did you... Like, just give me a sense of the strategy and the decision to leverage that into something more.
Yeah, of course. So it started, like I said, off that tour. I had to pivot my entire image at that point because I was viewed more as I had followers because of the content I made, not so much because of myself as a person, right? So at that point, I was gaining followers because of viral videos and people enjoyed the content, but they didn't have that insight into my life or who really Josh Richards was. So I utilized the tour to actually pivot my career and start becoming more of a entertainer because of who I am than because of the videos I put out. And what that did was allowed me to create a much more engaged fan base, allowed actually the group to start of sway because we kind of created or broke the stigma of TikTokers where you had to live up to this Disney Channel clean image, go by what the manager tells you, go by what the industry standard is. And we kind of just said, we're going to do our own thing and still be successful at it.
So for all the people of my age and demo, can you explain this idea of Sway House? I mean, I've gotten to know you and the other guys a bit, but you know, anybody 40 and over doesn't really get it. So can you explain it?
Yeah. So Sway is a content house and it's a collective group of 8 boys. We all live together in this under this one roof. So you can already imagine what craziness we're getting up to, but we would use each other's following and likeness on the app to create a mass amount of content and continuously just push each other and grow off of each other's platforms.
And then, so what, when you first started, you know, Sway House, right, you were one of the original ones. When did the business opportunities beyond just partnerships start materializing in your mind, right? Because you simply could have leveraged your brand and sort of done things for fees. But I've watched you over the last couple of years decide take equity here, take equity there. How did that all reveal itself to you?
Yeah, when I started talking with my business partner, Michael Gruen, and just a few other of the boys in the Sway House, a couple mentors, et cetera, I learned very quickly that it was much more important to own everything I was touching than to be paid $10,000 to do an Instagram story.
But it's funny because it applies to you too, right? Own the IP if you
exactly,
can.
Exactly. So instead of focusing so much on the selling out to Bang Energy to do $1 million campaign or the I'm going to post and my whole entire Instagram story is just going to look like a billboard section, right? Our strategy was let's focus on creating the most engaged audience out there. They're going to love us for us. They're going to see it. We're going to be very authentic, show our image, show who we are. And what that created was this very intrigued customer base of millions and millions of people. So then when we went and we launched our own product, like Bryce and I co-founded Annie Energy together, they're running to the website to buy it. They want to be a part of that story with us and they feel a part of it because of how much we let them in our lives. So just to focus on the equity, we've always looked at as one of the most important things in building our brands.
So back to TikTok for half a second. I know you got involved with Triller, right? And mm-hmm. This is something I've debated for a long time. I've watched TikTok evolve. Obviously, it's everywhere. And yet I read, you know, the U.S. government saying that it's basically an espionage threat to the United States, right? So I'm fascinated by your generation in particular is very conscious about privacy. Mark Zuckerberg mm-hmm. tell us all about that as he testifies in Congress. And then you have TikTok, right, which is being identified by like Senator Schumer and Senator Rubio, both sides of the aisle, as a massive counterintelligence threat. Just help me reconcile that, how this generation could be so passionate about privacy but not worried about, you know, TikTok.
Yeah, I think that what happened is obviously TikTok came out first, became this huge viral app and everyone had it on their phones. And then we hear all the news, right? The news comes to us all after everyone's got it already downloaded. So, I mean, a big part of why we went over to Triller or we started our talks with Triller is because a large part of my journey has always been about protecting the creator. And when we hear stuff like data being shared and all these rumors, of course that scares me because now I'm not following that journey anymore, or I'm actually doing the opposite of what I set out to do. So that's why we partnered with Triller. That's why we did a large press run. That's why the boys at the Sway House decided, you know what, we need to move our audience. We have a responsibility when we have this influence and this audience in front of us. We need to move them to a platform we know they're going to be safe and still be able to see our content.
Are you surprised that nobody seems to care that much though? Like I would just, it's a blanket statement, but I would say generally speaking, yeah. I care about Triller, care about privacy as it relates to TikTok.
I'm surprised how people like only brought it up that one time with TikTok. I'm surprised that it hasn't been a more general topic of discussion just with social media.
Yeah, I don't know what to make of it, but let's put that aside for a second. Let's contribute to the problem then. Let's act like it's not an issue. What advice do you have to those, you know, do you see TikTok becoming like a monetization platform for mainstream brands? And I'm, you're going to say probably already is, but to the, if you could educate us a little bit about how to win at TikTok and what does the future look like?
Yeah, no, I definitely think it's a massive monetization platform for brands, but also it allows you to have a really cool engagement, or I guess like it allows you to tell the story of your brand as well, right? Like we see people like the NFL has a TikTok account and it absolutely kills. And it's brought in, I feel like, so much attention through COVID to football. I think that probably they even obtained a brand new audience that they didn't have before because of how viral they're, like, they know what to do. They're posting the funny moments at football games. They're posting the heartfelt moments when a player's worked his butt off for 10 years and then finally wins a Super Bowl, right? They're posting mic'd up content, all these different things that would not only be entertaining for the football fans, but for people that aren't even, right? So it's like this free marketing you get.
And what would it take for Triller to have that meteoric trajectory that TikTok has had?
I think exactly what they're doing right now. I mean, being over there, being chief strategy officer, I'm able to help them a lot with working on the monetization of features. They have always making sure we're looking for the creator first and trying to make sure that we're helping out the artists, we're helping out the users on the app.
So you see it. It's underway is your point. You'd say, you would argue, yeah. What else? We just did a session internally with my team today about Clubhouse. We were hanging out on Clubhouse a couple of weeks ago and whatnot. You were just sort of observing, which I was impressed by. You actually were just watching, right? And sort of no need to dominate the conversation. What do you think about Clubhouse?
The thing that's so intriguing, I believe, about Clubhouse is it's introducing a brand new influencer. There's going to be a social media creator that we've never thought would be possible or have really attached ourselves to before. And it's going to be the creator that has the most intellect, right? Like the one teaching us stuff, the one that's able to give me a rundown on what I should do when I have a $20 extra in my bank account to spend. Like, how do I turn that into an account that's going to work towards my retirement, right? Like, that's what we're seeing with Clubhouse, which is so cool, and such a targeted audience with those creators too. When you have 500,000 followers on Clubhouse and your chat rooms are always about, let's just say, investing, that niche audience you have is going to be so much more for like a company like Robinhood to go and put their money behind than they would be to come to me. That's or another TikToker that's just posting TikTok dances, right? Maybe if you went to me, you're getting 10 million extra views. But when you go to the Clubhouse creator with 500,000 followers that's just talking about investment 24/7, you got that entire niche audience. You're going to the exact customer you want.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think there's something magical and serendipitous about TikTok. And what I like about it, lowers the bar. Like even you and I talking, we had to at least comb our hair. You know, you go on TikTok in the middle of the night, maybe you didn't, I don't know. But TikTok in the middle of the night, you can just chill out, hang out, jump on. You're talking to people. There's something wonderfully democratic. It's a little chaotic and incoherent, but I think that gets sorted out. But I think it's here to stay and really, really powerful is my gut.
Yeah, for sure. I think people look at it and think maybe it's just a phenomenon or it's gonna go away because they think, oh, they have no revenue, right? Like Clubhouse has no revenue. But I don't think Twitter had revenue for 4 years.
Right. I'm going to get into some of your business things. Let's talk about, I want to break them down. You have so many and they're so interesting. So we can go deeper onto whatever it is that excites you the much. Tell a little bit about the Fan Control Football League. How much are you involved in it? And tell everyone the basic idea.
Yeah. So I believe that, I mean, it's changing sports or how sports are viewed in the digital age. Like if you're an avid sports fan or you're behind one team, right? And how many times have you yelled at the TV at a coach or yelled at a player, right? Or yelled at the TV saying they should have made a different play call, etc. Well, now instead of just yelling at no one, you can actually make a difference in the game. You can watch these players, these actually really talented football players play, and then at the same time, not only back your team and support your team and et cetera, you actually get to call the plays for them. And as you get, you know, you're making those good play calls. As you get more associated with the team, you start to hold a little bit more power in your calls as well. So I just think that it's going to be so fun for the major football fan.
And are you investing in a league, or you have your own team, or how does it work?
Yeah, so right now we're on as kind of like advisors. We're going to be helping out, but then as time goes on, definitely want to look at having our own team.
Okay, what else are you excited about? I could literally go down. You are probably involved with like 10 major business initiatives. Tell me what you're excited about.
Yeah, I'm super excited about Breaker. I think what they're able to do with connecting the independent artists to a TikTok creator is outstanding, and the fact that they're doing it more focus on the arbitrage play than just, you know, feeding the rich get richer mentality, which I think a lot of companies go after. It's like now the TikTok creator with 300K, 400K to maybe 2 million, they can go on this platform and be connected with an artist that, you know, they don't want to go sign to a label and lose all their rights. And a lot of artists are focusing on that right now, is that the rights are more important than going to a label and getting an advance. So these independent artists are able to go and pay $400, $500, $300 to $1,000 to get these TikTok creators to start using their sounds. They start promoting it, right? And what ends up happening is now you're going to start seeing these independent artists break without needing the help from a label. And we've seen songs break on TikTok before. I've broken songs on TikTok before. So not only does it help out the independent artists, but now you're going to start seeing creators get credit where credit's due when they break these songs. It allows them to actually even go further than just getting paid $500, $1,000. If you create a relationship with that independent artist, you can actually own part of that song. And when that goes to the label, like, you're going to get part of what that musician or artist is making. So I think they're doing really cool stuff. I think that Unhide has been a really cool experience with Ellen's team. It's been awesome. I mean,
why don't you explain that to everybody?
Yeah. Definitely one of my focuses. I'm a dog guy. I love dogs, right? I have a husky, and then my family has a dog back home, and I just always grew up around them. So with Unhide, what's really cool is that they're on the path to, you know, stop the fur and faux fur and every. So they're doing faux fur, and it is probably the most comfortable blanket I've ever used in my life. Like, I went home for Christmas and brought one back for my family, and I should have brought five because it just started a war. Like, my family was just going at each other. So
right.
What they're doing there is amazing. A lot of people think that, you know, when you're shearing sheep, it's like, oh, well, you're not killing the animal. It's, you know, the animal's fine. What they don't know is the amount of infections that get caused from mass shearing, the amount of sheep that still end up dying because of the habitats they're raised in, or just the atmosphere. So that, and then kind of to follow that story, I mean, Dog for Dog with Snoop Dogg has been a really cool one as well, where we're giving back a bag of dog food every time one's purchased to a shelter, because the euthanization rates in the States is ridiculous. There's about 700,000 dogs that are killed a year in shelters.
So now looking at the different businesses that you're involved in, right? So obviously you're taking equity and maybe getting fee for services. Not sure about that part, but regardless, walk us through your criteria and how has it evolved in the last year? Are is Josh Richards deals that you're doing today very different than a year ago? And like, how are you leveling up?
Yeah, I mean, I think that as I get more involved in the angel investment world, into even just now how we focus on the typical brand deal, when companies come to us, we're always looking for equity instead of cash, right? Or now we focus a lot more on things I'm also passionate about. Sometimes we're doing deals where in the past they were more me, you know, dipping my toes in the water, figuring out the investment world, figuring out entrepreneurship. But as I'm getting more comfortable as an investor, as an entrepreneur, I'm starting to realize what I love, you know, what companies I really want to go work with. So I think the passion side of things is coming along.
How much of your energy now is outbound versus coming in? I know Michael, by the way, does a great job. Crazy, you know, maniac. He's coming up with great ideas all the time. I'm just curious, how much are you now directing your energy outbound versus, you know, selecting from what comes into you?
You know, I feel like our group's always been very focused on outbound. We love going, like, we love playing offense, going out, finding new ideas, just always do, like, we'll do calls throughout the week where there's no creative, like, there's no agenda. We're simply just calling the person because we believe that they are powerful in a certain area and we want to learn from them, right? So, I mean, we're always just going out and trying to find new things to do, new areas, new passion projects, et cetera.
Well, I think it's such an important topic for anybody with a degree of influence and reach is be intentional about what you're going after as opposed to only sifting through what comes to you. It's so hard, especially when you have a lot of deal flow or a lot of opportunity. It's just easy to only assess the opportunity that came through your inbox as opposed to saying, wait a second, like Clubhouse is going to be really big. I should get on. I mean, that's actually a good example. When you saw that, did you pick up the phone and say, how do I get in? You know, call Mark Andreessen or whoever, like, can I be an investor? Or not?
I mean, I think that's how our mindset works, right? Like, we'll see really cool products or we'll see these trends start in social media, especially when people like myself or Griffin, we're very involved in TikTok. So we see these trends sometimes earlier than others. We're able to hop in there or call the right people and get those calls set up so that we can, you know, state our value prop and try to work something out.
So talk me through the genesis of the podcast you started doing with Barstool Sports, like, and what was the logic, if there was any, or you just wanted to have some fun?
Yeah, no, that was definitely very strategical. I mean, at the start, it came from luck. There was a lot of drama going on in the social media world. And then he tweeted out about Wiggle Dickers coming up on his feed. And so my team,
the audience is going, what is he talking about? But anyway.
Yeah. So Michael, he starts working really hard at trying to set up a call and put me in front of Dave and just talk it out. So we set up a live stream. We started talking on a live stream. From there on, Snapchat reached out and asked to do a show because they liked how me and Dave were on the live. Dave said no right away. He was like, no way, I'm working with Snapchat. So then we kind of had to pivot the combo, came across a podcast, and that's where that all came from.
What's the number one thing that you haven't done yet that you want to do? From a media standpoint or show standpoint or, you know, investing standpoint?
Yeah, I think from the entrepreneurial world, one thing that I still haven't done is like have an exit. That's obviously super exciting when you get like your first exit on something or a return from an investment. So like, I'm always looking for that, but
amazing feeling because you almost believe it's all make believe on paper, which usually it is make believe.
Right.
Then a wire transfer arrives. You're like, oh, like it really is not make believe. Sometimes a lot of times it is make believe, but
yeah. So, I mean, I think that, and then also, I mean, I think building out almost more than just having myself on social media, I kind of want to build out an entire empire and be very implemented in the sports world. So,
okay. So you want to be a sports team owner at some point, you think?
I think so. Yeah. I would definitely want to own part of a sports team.
Okay. All right. Well, keep the questions coming because I see a lot of good ones. I'll get to them in another couple of minutes. How do you want to be described when people talk about Josh Richards right now? Are you comfortable being called an influencer or you want to, you know, graduate from that moniker?
I mean, I prefer when I'm called like an entertainer on the social media side than like a TikToker, but I want to be seen also as the entrepreneur I am. And I think that's something that gets left out, but definitely has been more of a focal point lately. And like, we've tried really hard to make that a standpoint in the press as well.
So let's start some questions. Amanda, Josh, how many hours a day would you say you spend on TikTok?
Besides filming's where I spend my time. But when I'm doing something, like, I don't spend a lot of time just like going through that, probably an hour a day.
Right. I was gonna say, I don't think you probably spend nearly as much time as people probably, you know, think, right?
No, sorry, I got to move. I know this sucks, but
no, it's good actually. I was getting kind of like, I was hoping you'd start moving.
Just got to move around for a second.
By the way,
because I'm getting
yelled. Is there ever going to be a LinkedIn strategy for you?
I got to start using it more because of the demographic that's actually on it. Like, you talk about how, you know, they don't really know the TikTok world. Like, I need to keep expanding into different audiences. I can't just stick to the TikTok world, and that would help. Also, LinkedIn helps a lot with like the entrepreneurial side of things. Right. So
you know what's amazing about LinkedIn too, which I've become very passionate about it, is just one, it's very democratic. and you don't have to have a massive audience to reach a massive audience.
Right.
And, you know, if you have a great piece of content, it'll migrate. Two, it's unconditionally positive and supportive. So sometimes it's a little vanilla, but who cares? It's really interesting. But to your point, you know what's amazing? You get the report saying, oh, wow, I just reached 1 million people, of which 1,000 worked at Amazon, 1,000 worked at IBM. It's just I feel like the reason everyone who's watching this right now, I'm extracting this from Josh, is because you probably think, oh, 19-year-old on TikTok. Like, it's easy to discount the amount of work that goes into building that audience and how smart these creators are. And number two, the future belongs to the content creators. So if you're not creating content, you might not be part of the future. So you got to be comfortable telling your story. But I think I could really see you crushing it on here. But let's look at this, Brian. What's the best way to convince, for lack of a better term, the older generation about the power of TikTok? I tend to see an age grab.
Yeah. I mean, here's the thing. Obviously, there's always going to be people that are like slow to join when there's these new trends. And often what you see, it's the older people, right, that don't join it right away. But I think as we start to see more brands come into TikTok, like people like the NFL, et cetera, and we start to see this. TikTok went into a press frenzy right off the start, right? It was like the biggest app. It took over. And then right after that, it gets the whole Chinese government press situation and so on and so forth. So I think as that starts to calm down, you'll start to see more people like come into TikTok, actually, which is strange. You would think usually when it's like trending in the media, that's when everyone would join. But usually that's when like the young kids join and then it gets to their parents. And then it's just going to go up and up like that.
I agree with you. What's this is a good question. What's been your biggest misstep?
I think I know it's when I came to LA, I just got really excited as like a 17-year-old kid when I first moved out here and being introduced to, you know, living on my own, pretty much calling all the shots, having these responsibilities. Like I didn't realize how detrimental I think partying was going to be, or just not focusing so much on the work.
Okay. And hold on 1 second. I had one right. This is a really interesting question. I mean, I'm curious, I'll just summarize. Are you making content for your audience now, or are you making content for you? And was there a pivot along the way?
Right. I think right now I'm in that pivot. I think at this moment in time, I'm in the pivot of creating some more content that's for me versus necessarily always just to please an audience. I think that's kind of the leisure you get as you become bigger as a creator, is like you get to start implementing more and more of what you actually want to post instead of just trying to get views, which is super cool. But that's why I talk about trying to get more implemented in the sports world a ton.
All right. From Michael, what sports team do you want to own?
I think my dream would probably be either part of the Bills. I love Buffalo Bills. Or like Toronto Raptors or Toronto Maple Leafs. It's got to be like something around there.
Right. Hey, just keep that. Like, you know what's great? I always talk about this. The law of compounding applies as much to money as it does to professional success. So by virtue of the fact that you started at your age, right? I mean, I can't imagine what talking to you in another 10 years is going to be like. You think you'll end up on Shark Tank next to Mark Cuban?
I mean, that would be cool.
You're probably like, what's Shark Tank? It's not cool anymore.
No, I know Shark Tank still.
Awesome. All right, I'm gonna let you go. Two things though, so that you can make me look really cool. My daughter Lucia is watching, as is my niece Brooke is watching. So just saying that to you will get me a lot of street cred.
Brooke and Lucia, Matt, he's the man. All right, you guys need to understand that.
All right, Josh and I are going to do something really big together. We haven't figured out what it is, but I would love talking to all his colleagues. You'd be shocked how smart and entrepreneurial this generation is. And so don't dismiss it. Don't dismiss TikTok. Don't dismiss people just because they're, you know, doing content in ways that you don't understand. I used to dismiss it too, all the little dancing videos on TikTok. But these people are very, very smart. And so take the time to understand what they're doing, and because they're the trend spotters. And so, Josh, I'm going to make a lot of money off of you because you're going to tell me the next Clubhouse before anybody else sees it. And then I'm going to buy a lot of it.
Exactly. That's the plan. I'll come in and buy some of it with you.
All right. Let's do it. Thanks again.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Take care, everybody.